Yes, so these are the topics, guys, we are covering today. SDLC models, so waterfall model, agile model, V model, RAD is rapid application development, spiral model, rational unified process, RUP. And these are some of the very core models which are used even today in industry. And this started in the late 90s, around 1960, 1980. The first waterfall model came into picture and it was the first model. And today, in most of the projects, in the small projects in IT, we use Agile model. Now, Agile has many different models. So we have a separate chapter for Agile model because BA plays a very important role in the Agile model. So maybe for some of them who have worked in the project management experience, like for example, Christine, so it might be a repetition for you. You might be able to relate the concepts, the theoretical concepts of whatever you have been experienced till now. Okay, so we can move ahead. So guys, this is a waterfall model and this is a pretty much simpler model, the basic model. And even today in many industries, in many, you can say the big projects, large projects, this model is used. And this is like a sequential stepwise model where you can see the first step is completed. If suppose the first step is of requirement. So requirement means getting the need or the functionality or the behavior or any other requirement. So in the session, in the demo session, I might have explained what the requirements are, how the requirements will be, but still I can explain you again. So guys, there are many types of requirements. For example, business requirement is the first type of requirement. The next is the stakeholder requirement. And third one is the transition requirement. Transition requirement can be a functional, solution requirement can be functional or non-functional. And the fourth is the transitional requirement. Now, okay, if you might feel that you don't know what is the functional and the main difference to understand is for the functional and non-functional requirement. For example, the functional requirement can be any functionality which is expected or desired to be there in a particular product. So the functionality can be audit tracking, can be the maintenance of the customer account, can be authentication to log into the particular site, can be some external interfaces requirement. That is also a functional requirement. Maybe some administrative functions, for example, creating the roles profile. So some like in Salesforce or any SAP CRM or Oracle Sybil, you have this functionality for defining the hierarchy and the role wise. So what will be visible to whom? So that comes into the authentication processes or profiles and roles. And some of them might have the reporting requirements. That is also a functional requirement. And in non-functional requirement, mostly these are the supporting requirements which may not come into a direct functionality, but these are very much essential. For example, performance, scalability, availability, reliability, serviceability. For example, if suppose you're accessing some site, take example of most common site, some Facebook or Gmail or e-commerce like Amazon. So that Amazon website should perform quickly, should be very responsive. You know, the website should be responsive. So those such terms, such requirements comes into non-functional requirements, which are related to the performance or maybe capacity, like how many users can log in to Yahoo News or how many users can log in like search a query on Google without like hampering the speed. That comes into the performance requirements. So these requirements also we are having, like maybe I know it's in the fifth or sixth session we are going to cover everything about requirements. Okay, so this is the first step, guys, to get the requirements for the particular project. Second is design. Now designing part comes with the data structure, with software architecture, or maybe some of the requirements I said about the interfaces, and then we have to represent those interfaces, for example, in the algorithms. So if suppose there is some site, there is some sales cycle in the salesforce.com, it needs to, in US, you have a Comcast client, right? For the telecom, you have Cisco. So for Comcast client, they have the interfaces like mTORIS. They have the interfaces to have the customer to for the interview process, where they have the installation instructions or maybe details they get it from the customer. Again, it's different to the third interface, that is SOAP or REST. So designing about whatever the requirements are there and gathered, that's the second step. The third is the actual implementation when designing is done, and designing can be like FRDs, BRDs preparation. Then in FRDs, you explain the functionality, you explain the flow, and this FRDs or maybe called as FS, function specifications, then it is being referred to the developer. Developer does the work of implementation, source code, database, user documentation, and testing. So in implementation phase, all the necessary work, the core work for a particular product is done. So the first two steps are to help out what exactly to be implemented. And the third step of implementation is the exact coding stage, where you write the codes, where you write the triggers, where you write all the necessary things of testings, etc. So the test cases and testing acceptance criteria is also written in the third step. Next step is testing stage. You test all the functionality developed by the developer. You check the BA checks whether the functionality is developed according to the requirement, whether there is a defect or whether there is a requirement change. Then the fourth step is installation or deployment, whatever you call it. If it is a deployment, it will be a transition from a developer's environment to the staging environment to production environment. Okay. Maybe in between UAT will come, but here it's not there. So deployment is transferring from one environment to other environment, and installation is altogether installing a new software to a client at the client machine. Next is again maintenance. If after it went to production, so you might be aware, project management guys might be aware that there is a lot of maintenance support work goes on. A lot of bugs are there. Maybe some functionality issue is there. Maybe there is some change in the functionality. So ongoing or production support is very important. So these are the six steps: requirements, design, implementation, test, deployment, and maintenance. So guys, what do you think here? What is missing here? We can see the disadvantages and advantages in the later slide, but I'm just asking you, what is missing here? The step-by-step implementation is going on, but still, for me, as a BA, something is missing here, which is very important.
Is it a feedback loop?
Right, exactly, very good. So the customer is going to see the final product at the end of the step. From starting, it's just the team which is developing, and at the end of the customer see the final product. And if he's not satisfied or it is not up to his requirement, then definitely he is not going to, it's not going to add value to him. And there is no feedback, there is no you can say review thing done, there is no verification done in between while developing the functionality. So step-by-step implementation and directly end product is shown to the customer. Here lacks the visibility. So coming to the next slide, as I said, there are some advantages and disadvantages. Definitely there are some advantages, guys. Even if the feedback loop is not there, I can explain you where it is exactly used. And nowadays also it is used at a large scale waterfall model. So this is simple and easy to understand, easy to use also. There is no feedback, there is no delay. So the specific timeline is followed, and definitely there is no change requirement at all at any stage. Once the requirement is done, first step, the product will be delivered till end. There is no change in requirement. In later models, we will see how the feedback loops and how the review process works. And then chain of the requirements done, scope creep happens. So scope creep also is one of the major issue happening in Agile these days. So yeah, second advantage, it is easy to manage due to rigidity of the model. Each phase has specific deliverables and a review process. And only at that stage, not from the client. In this model, the phases are processed and completed at one time. Phases do not overlap. This is also one of the important point advantage. And as I said, disadvantages are more than advantages. No working software is produced until date during the life cycle, right? As I said, only at the end the customer is able to see the end product. So there is no prototype, or there is no in between, you can say the mock-up or anything is shown to the client, and getting the feedback, how it is, how the design is, how the UI looks, whether you are happy with the performance, whether you are happy with the security or privacy purposes for the particular website developed or particular product developed. So for long-term projects, this is a poor model, guys. This is, and these days in IT, for the smaller projects or smaller functionalities or many softwares, they don't follow Waterfall. But Waterfall is used in the projects which are very large. I mean, very large projects. For example, I can tell you, if suppose you have a project of, this is again a non-IT example, but this is the example where Waterfall is used. You have a project to build Burj Khalifa, or your project to build WTC, a big building, maybe 120, 130 floors. And at this level, you cannot have the customer in between to have the feedback after completion of 70 floors, 60 floors. You cannot change the design. You cannot change the requirements. So the requirements and everything has to be the first step only. Then only we can start with the second step of designing and implementation, third step. You remember this? The first slide I showed you, requirement, design, implementation. So requirement has to be the first step only. Requirement cannot come in between the building phase or the big project, maybe the metro building or the metro construction, maybe some bridge construction. Maybe there are some defense projects, which are very large projects where there is no requirement change in between. Requirement change cannot happen. It will lead to a big project failure. So this is the best practical example. Got it, guys? This model is used when the requirements are very known, clear, and fixed. Requirement cannot change. Product definition has to be stable. Technology is understood. There are no ambiguous requirements, and there is no change in requirements. This was about Waterfall model. The projects where requirements are 100% sure and fixed at the first stage, then only Waterfall model is used. Next comes Agile technology. Now, Agile methodology. Any questions, guys? Even if you have some questions, you can write it down. We can take it after the session, at the end of the session. Okay. Next is Agile methodology. Now, under Agile, there are many techniques. For example, there is Scrum methodology, there is Kanban, there is Extreme Programming, there is JIT, there is Lean. JIT is just in time, which is followed by most of the food chains. For example, McDonald's, they follow just in time. I mean, they don't pile up with the inventories. They prepare everything, and the throughput time from the customer orders to the product delivered, it is very less because of just in time technique. So these are some of the techniques used in Agile, specifically to IT, Scrum. So I'll explain about Scrum. When you say Agile here, I'll explain a sub part of Agile, that is Scrum. So what does Agile mean? Agile means a small incremental level of continuous development happens throughout the SDLC. Now, why this has came up? Because these days, after the the technology is changing at a very fast pace, and there is a lot of evolution going on. Every now and then, there will be a new smartphone, a new OS, a new product will be developed. Now, SAP till 1970, it was good. It was not deteriorated till 1990 also, I can say. But then afterwards, a lot of ERP systems came into existence. You have especially for CRM, we have Sugarfree, we have Epicor, we have Lawson, we have Salesforce, we have Oracle Siebel. So SAP CRM, what SAP has done is they have stopped the support for the CRM from 2019 because it no longer sustained in the market. Now, why this happened? No change or no innovation happened. So, I mean, technology disrupting everything, it's changing everything. And there is a lot of change happening these days. So the changing requirements, and even some of the times the user or the client is also not sure of what they exactly want. So they keep on changing the requirement during the phase of development process. The best example I can give you is of a smartphone, or you can take any, maybe some banking industry software where the requirement changes because the model changes, the design changes, maybe some leadership changes at the top after 3-4 years, and the requirement changes. The reconciliation, for example, in Credit Suisse, I can give you example. There was a reconciliation process where only credit risk and finance was considered. Later on, after 3 years, leadership came and told we also want market risk, because after 2008 crisis, subprime crisis in US, it was a very mandatory for the regulators to have the compliances issues, and they came up with many frameworks, many regulations, many compliances which should be followed by the IB, and there was a change in requirement after 2008 subprime crisis. So whatever softwares which were built from 2006 to 8, they have to change the requirement according to the regulatory compliance. So there is the external force here for the banking industry in order to get their software in line and aligned to the changing requirements. So requirement change can happen anytime, not internally, not from client. It can be sometime externally, that is from the regulators. Okay. So when there is a change in requirement and you need to incorporate those changes at that time, I think Agile is the best methodology. Okay. So what is a Scrum? So there is no need of a management or manager here. It is a self-organized team. Every member has their own task. There are different softwares used in Scrum. So even for Agile and Scrum, we have a separate chapter, but still I'll explain here as this covers all the SDLC models. So see, if you can see the plan, design, build, the first loop you can see, guys, the sprint one, plan, design, build, test, and review. So these are some of the same steps in Waterfall, but then this is at the sprint one level, iterative model. Second is sprint two. Third is sprint three. I can just highlight this if you, it will be helpful for you. So this is what I'm talking about, the sprint one. Oh, sorry. Then this is sprint two. This is sprint three. So what they do, for example, if we want to build some product, they divide it in, suppose, five different features to be built step by step. So first features, the task and the user stories are broken down accordingly to design the first feature in the sprint one. Sprint one is nothing but a particular timeline. For example, 2 weeks. In 2 weeks of time, a particular team will deliver these many features. The sprint one, in sprint, there is a daily Scrum meeting. There is a retrospection meeting. There is a planning meeting and there is demonstration meeting. So in planning and estimation meeting, what does the team does it? It estimates the user stories, give the time, 3 days, 5 days. It come up with the product backlog and the proper planning among the team. And then it start every day. They in the daily Scrum meeting, they tell what we have done from yesterday till today, what we will be able to do from today to tomorrow, and is there any impediments? And after the sprint is completed, there is a demonstration meeting which is conducted by a BA. So as a BA, even I have delivered many demonstration meetings where I have delivered the features developed by a particular developer in a particular sprints. Sprint one ensures the feature one, sprint two ensures feature three, sprint three ensures feature four, three. For example, if some requirement change is there here, after the demonstration, client says, hey, I don't want this. I actually needed something different. So what we do, we as a BA either write the new user story for the change in requirement, or we register a defect which was supposed to be built the way, but then it is not been developed and tested. So that is a defect verification process again performed by a BA. So what this Agile or Sprint ensures is requirement is correct and the feedback is taken from client. The sign off is taken after each feature is developed. So at the end, there is no surprise for anyone, neither the design team or the developer team or the client. There is no surprise here. So these are the advantages. Deliver a working product faster than the conventional linear development model. Definitely, as I told you, every task is like accountable and it is being measured, timeline, everything is in place. Customer feedback at every stage ensures that the end deliverable satisfies their expectation. So at every sprint, the customer has to review the demonstration and approve the user story that this is completed. Customer means here I'm talking about product owner. So there are different roles. There is a Scrum Master, there is a product owner, there is a Scrum team. Okay. But the nowhere a manager comes here. A Scrum Master is also someone who facilitates the Scrum to be there, arranging the meetings, making sure the product owner is there, making sure the sufficient stories are there in the backlog in order to get the user stories in the next sprints. OK. that those are the facilitators. There is no manager. This is a self-driven team. And this is very hot model. And right now, if you write in your CV that you know Agile, you have learned the concept of Agile, and if you you can crack the interview, you can answer the interview, because these are the questions they will ask you. Who is the product owner? How the stories are prioritized? Who prioritizes? How the estimation is done? Are there any scope creep, or is there any the epic which was broken down into the user stories and which was dragged till many sprints? So that is a delay. So you have to explain such situations. So there are many software guys to work with the Scrum. One of the software I know is Agile. One is TFS Foundation Server. One is Clear Case or some IBM software. I don't remember the exact name now. But Rally, I have worked. I have worked personally in Rally, where user stories are there. So let me check if I have something on my machine to show you. Yeah, so this is one of the example of Visual Studio where you can see. Can you see my screen, guys? Hello, is everyone awake?
Yes.
Okay, so this is any other, like there are many softwares I said to use the Scrum and do the project planning. So this is any other Scrum model, TFS Foundation Server. So this is by Microsoft. And you can see the user stories are there, the user ID is there, and these are some of the internal things, guys. I can't show much, but I can help you. This gives the team name and etc. This is the sprint 1, sprint 2, a different name for a sprints. There are stories here, there are features here, and there are also after the sprint, you will be, where is my screen, which I was sharing? Yeah, here it is. So after the sprint is completed, there are burn down charts. I mean, throughout the sprint also, we watch the burn down charts. For example, how is the progress going on in a particular sprint, whether it is as per the time, as per the plan, and if it is not, what should be ensured, what measures should be taken in order to control and bring back the curve to the ideal curve. And at the end, we can see whether the sprint was successful or not. Now, when to use Agile? As I said, when the requirements are not clear at all, even if like it's very vague, some of the times customer wants, or even they don't know what they wanted. And this definitely happens in IT industry, because there is nothing to show here. So, I mean, we should have some prototypes, some mock-up should be made. And in BRD and FRD, we make sure that we are very much sure about the scope about the project. And when there is a requirement change, as in a small functionality or the feature change, it's not that customer has asked for a laptop and we are developing a product of mobile or something. It's just a small change in software. And the product when needs to go early in the market, because the development is very fast here. So Agile practical. Okay, going back. Any questions here in Agile? Anyone? Ritika, Anisha, Olubunga, Viswa. And one more, Christine. Any questions, guys, for Agile, for Waterfall?
Hello?
Yes.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So how many ways Agile works? Like you said Scrum was one of it.
Right. So Scrum was
so
one
I
of
went-
which is widely used in IT. So I'm being sticking to the IT here part only, and I'm explaining only Agile. Scrum will come in later chapters. Maybe I think session 9 or session 10, there is a special session for Scrum. There is a complete chapter for Agile in which I will explain Scrum, Kanban, Extreme Programming, Lean, JIT, everything.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. But from BA perspective, the most important is Scrum. That's what I can say.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. The next is a V model. Now, how V model is different from Agile? Agile is, it is a iterative process. Like they do repeat sorry, they do repeat the cycle. They do repeat everything like design, implementation, testing, deliver. Design, implementation, testing, deliver. So this cycle is completed at iterative level, at sprint one, sprint two, sprint three, at an incremental level. Remodel is something where side by side, both the steps happen, verification and validation. So remodel means verification and validation at each stage. So if you can see, implement planning, requirements, architecture, detailed design, implementation. Now, after requirements, there is a acceptance also which is done. So I mean, it looks like a V, okay? Each phase must be completed before the next phase begin. It is same as a waterfall, but then a verification is done at each level. So I can explain you what does this mean. Next step will be fulfilled in the V model only after completing the previous one. But then in waterfall model, you see it is done. I mean, there was no verification happening. There was no validation happening in waterfall, and here it happens. So that's the difference between waterfall and V model. Okay, I'll tell you. Any guess, guys, what is the difference between verification and validation? You might be very confused to hear these words. So I'm just asking you. Any guesses? There is no right and wrong answer. You can just say what do you think. Okay, anyone? Okay, I'll tell you. Verification is nothing but it is ensuring that the software is of high quality and it is properly designed and developed. That is error free. Okay. Verification is like a high quality software, error free, bugs free, and which is performing in a good way, a quality software. And validation means whether the software is built as per the requirement. I mean, whether the business requirement is satisfied, whether the software is according to the requirement or not. That is validation. Did you get the difference? So whatever customer is expectations, are they satisfied? This is done by validation. And verification is the correctness and the error free of the software. So I can say, if you see the first part of the V, this is the proper project steps, and the second part, it is all about the testing part. That is ensuring the product works error free, ensuring everything. Verification and validation is done side by side at each step. This is just a high level design. You got the difference between verification and validation? Okay. I'll take silence as you understood and I'll go ahead. So what is the advantage? Again, simple and easy to use, as same for waterfall. And each like testing activities like planning, test designing happens well before the coding. So this saves a lot of time. So unit testing is also done during time of coding only. I mean, whenever we write some class or methods, some of them might have developed something. So I personally was a Python developer. So we do write the classes, dictionaries and list. We do write the methods. So the unit testing is ensuring whether the piece of a code is working correctly or not. So then and there, testing then and there. Integration testing is something when you want to integrate it with the external interfaces, or when you combine two or three modules or two or three softwares, and then the integration testing comes in picture. The UAT is user acceptance testing, comes at the last stage after integration testing, where users will themselves test in the UAT environment. As I said, deployment environment are there, testing, staging, development staging, UAT and production. So in UAT environment is the last deployment environment where users test the application developed, whether it's up to the mark, whether whatever their expectations are there, are they satisfying, the business needs are satisfied. So that is the UAT. And next is production. So unit testing, integration testing, if I go back here, you can see unit testing, integration testing, systems and acceptance testing, and then maintenance. So what I understand, did you get, guys, if you have any questions, let me know if I'm being fast or if I'm being slow. I'm not getting if you're understanding or not. So when to use a V-shaped model is when the requirements are again clearly defined and fixed. So it's the same as the waterfall. As I said, step-by-step implementation is there. The only advantage we have here is we have the verification happening. We have the validation happening. I mean, we have the validation from customer at each level. Okay. I'll go to the next. Next is the rapid application development, RAD, which is a short form we use these days. And it is a type of incremental model like Agile, but not same as Agile. In RAD model, the components of the function are developed in parallel as they are the mini projects. So you can see here, requirement planning phase, user design phase, construction phase, and cutover phase. A workshop utilizing the structured discussion of a business problems is a requirement planning phase. Then user design phase is user to participate in the non-technical discussion of the system. Construction phase is productivity tools such as code generators, screen generators, and cutover phase is installation of a system, user acceptance testing, and user criteria. So in this particular RAD, there is a very fast development which happens to reduce development time. It increases reusability of the components. For example, some component may be used in parallel if you want to build a system for credit risk, market risk, and finance. So if suppose some of the things are very core to these both the three of the families, okay, so you can build a particular function and feature, and you can use it in parallel projects which are going. For example, if I build a product for credit risk, you can use that particular feature for market risk as well as finance. So these are just advantages and disadvantages, guys. You can go through the slide. It's not it's just a theoretical part. It's not that important. And again, when the requirements are not fully understood and you want to see whether we can reuse the particular feature from one product to the different product which is being designed and developed parallelly, we have to use RAD, rapid application development. Okay, I'll move to the next one. These are some of the models which are very theoretical, and these definitely have the practical examples, but hardly I have seen in my career that they are used. And there are few softwares for the RAD which are like where you can do the parallel development of the products. So some of the softwares are OutSystem, Zoho Creator, Visual Lens. Have you heard anyone about it? Nintex or Filmmaker Pro? Okay, these are just some of the softwares used. So now spiral model. Now this is one of the model which was widely used after waterfall model drawbacks were noticed and registered by many IT industries. So this model came into picture, spiral model. So spiral model, as you can see from the diagram, I'm sorry. So it's a combination of a iterative development process and the sequential linear development. So whatever we have studied till now. So V model is an enhanced version of waterfall model. Waterfall model is a sequential model where the implementation happens step by step. Agile model is an iterative model, incremental level model. So sequential model and iterative model, the combination of both is a spiral model. The spiral model majorly has four phases. You can see the four quadrants here in this graph. So planning, risk analysis, engineering, and evaluation. So evaluation is done at this, you can see my pointer. Evaluation is done at this corner. So it starts from the requirements, again, design, implementation, planning. So everything, like for example, if something is designed and something is then developed, then again, it is being evaluated and reviewed by the client at every stage. So spiral model is along with incremental and sequential, a combination of incremental and sequential. I have never used a spiral model in my life, guys, to be frank enough, but I can explain you theory part and I can tell you. So the most common and practical example is for the spiral model is evolution of Microsoft Windows operating system. This was completely end-to-end developed by spiral model. There is one more proper example, Gantt chart software. So Gantt Pro is a tool for simple task handling tool. Maybe so for like we explained, I explained yesterday, right? Jira, and there are many tools where the proper project management and task management is done. So Gantt Pro is a tool which was developed by spiral model, and evolution of Microsoft Windows operating system is completely done on spiral model. So the most advantage is the risk is analyzed here at every step. So the project at such level where Microsoft Windows is built, definitely spiral model is helpful. And it is not for the small project, guys. It is only for the big and long running projects. So Windows is such project where maintenance is throughout. I mean, till today, even I am using Windows. Everyone is using Windows. Till today, they have to come up with the new versions and they have to maintain and ensure the compatibility with the previous versions. So when to use spiral model, when cost and risk evaluation is important for the medium high risk projects where the risk is high, where you see the project can go long run, there can be the change in requirement, there can be a lot of versions coming up, and when the requirements are complex, maybe you want to build up with some new product line altogether. Okay, so the next is a rational unified process. Again, this is the iterative software development process framework. And now this is object oriented, guys. When I say object oriented, it means any most of you, but some of you might have worked in the development part, maybe, or heard about it or learned about it. Object oriented programming, CO, OOPS concept, etc. So the same concept is used here. The approach is of the object oriented. For example, whatever we in object oriented, the importance is like in C, the importance was not given to the object. Here in object oriented programming, the importance was given to the object. So here, when I say object, it means specific to a particular granular small thing, a specific element. So RUP, again, there are four phases for RUP, rational unified process. First is inception, second is elaboration, third is construction, and fourth is a transition. The core idea is envisioned in the inception process. In the elaboration, the use cases and architecture are designed. In the construction, activities from design to the completed product. I mean, they complete the product here in construction. Transition is then follow up with the maintenance or maybe some customer satisfaction. So the RUP puts an what are the advantages of RUP? It puts an emphasis on addressing very early risk areas, and it does not put either a strong focus on the documents or the ceremonies, etc. The main example of RUP, I'm also thinking, guys, even I don't have the practical example. So this is like the at each level, if suppose we have to build some big ERP software where we want, like, stakeholders are very big here and a large number of stakeholders. If we want to build some ERP, then we have to deal with customers, partners, we have to deal with the suppliers, and some regional consultants, some legal consultant to ensure the process is continuously updated and is delivered to the quality up to the mark. So RUP is like working with large number of stakeholders where we have to build a large software like ERP, and the main focus remains on the product itself and its quality, because this particular ERP system should be satisfied. Now ERP is used by many, I mean internal employees for the planning purposes, for the forecasting purposes, by the suppliers to see the logistics and see everything, the billing process, for the financial, by the accounting people to see the billing and accounting and financial and controlling processes. So ERP is used by many stakeholders. It's a large project, and there RUP should be used, where the detailed object level of monitoring is done by each of the stakeholders in the development in these four phases: inception, elaboration, construction, and transition. This is again theoretical. I have personally not worked in RUP development, but these are some of the theoretical concepts which will help you to understand. So here we comes to an end, guys. This completes all the 5 to 6 models we have learned. So waterfall model, I'll repeat again. Waterfall model is a sequential model. Agile model is an incremental or iterative model. V model is a combination of iterative and sequential model. Then we have seen something called as RAD, rapid application development, which means a parallel development of a software going on, and some of the features can be reused. You remember, right? RAD example I gave of credit risk, market risk, and finance. Same module, same functionality, some core functionality can be used. For example, trade booking process. Trade booking process is used everywhere in finance, in treasury. Maybe you can say in the card business, in the investment banking, in the retail business. So these products, when particular investment bank build the products parallelly in all the different BUs, RAD is used. And RUP is something where we have a large number of stakeholders, a huge project which will support many stakeholders and many areas, which will tap on a logistics, supply chain, ERP, suppliers, customers. And if you want to build something related to that, RUP is used. And so for Agile, there are different, again, different technologies in Agile methodology. One is Scrum, one is JIT, Kanban. These terms we will explain you in the separate chapter known as Agile methodology. So this was more of a theoretical models which we use for the project development in SDLC, widely used in industry today. And this is what we are going to learn next, guys. So we are moving towards the core BA now. Then in the next chapter, in the next session, on Monday night, we are going to learn stakeholder definition, importance of stakeholder, onion diagram, power matrix is again, who is interested and who has a power to influence. So this I can explain you the PI matrix. RISI matrix is again responsible, accountable, etc. I can explain you in detail in the next. Maybe you can have a note down these points and read about it so that you may come up with the more questions, and I'll try to answer them. If at all I'm not able to answer, I'll learn about it and I'll answer, but definitely I'll be able to answer on these areas. And preparing the stakeholder map through Excel, etc. Managing the internal stakeholder, external stakeholder. So it's mainly about all the stakeholders. In the next chapter, we are going to learn. Till now, guys, the first session was on the introduction, general part of BA. Second is just the methodologies used in a software development lifecycle. These are some of the methodologies. This is the theoretical part. Still, I tried to give you some of the example where a huge building or a defense projects are built. Such projects support. Even today, they use waterfall model because there cannot be the change in requirement. A small project uses Agile. Spiral project is used. I mean, Microsoft Windows is a very good example for the spiral projects when high risk is involved and the long running projects and so on. So here we come to an end. Thank you guys for attending the session.